Olson for Minnesota Duluth, McIntosh for Catawba, and belongs to Duluth underway. The first semifinal of the day. Minnesota Duluth, 31-3 record. First semifinal for a team from their conference in over a decade. Couple of steps for Olson, and it's a travel right away. And Megan, you talked about it at the top. Minnesota Duluth has to limit the turnovers against that pressure.
Catawba does a great job of making you feel like you don't have very much time with the ball in your hands. Minnesota Duluth has to be strong and balanced every single time they catch on the perimeter.
First semifinal appearance in school history for Catawba. Tiptoeing downs, wild shot. And Duluth pulls it out with Rhodes. Team that averages 71 points per game, pride themselves on defense, allowing less than 56. Spinning, losing, Tatum Rhodes, and it's another turnover for Minnesota Duluth. Thorne, top scorer for the Indians. Thought three, slices inside, reverse layup, way strong. McIntosh, the O-board, triple team, doesn't care, and lays it in.
Nice job by McIntosh, sticking with the play, but Minnesota Duluth has to be committed to boxing out, creating contact and pushing back to get the rebound.
So the Northern Sun Intercollegiate Conference champs still looking for their first bucket. Here's Olson. Division II Player of the Year, hook shot, no.
Still a good look from Olson, but yet she was into three different Catawba jerseys. The help side on a kickout would have been better.
Janaya Downs, a senior, takes the three and hits. She's a 37% three-point shooter, best on the team. And Catawba already up by nothing.
Can't just make sure you're fighting over on down. She has confidence from three. Can't let her get confident early in this game.
Olson sees bodies again, this time undeterred.
It's impressive, Olson, her ability to still finish when she isn't squared up. She can still handle that contact and finish with authority.
Quick tempo in the early going. McIntosh ISO'd up, tries the flip layup, gets it again, and is fouled. Brooke Olson, and that's a story to watch. Olson battled foul trouble in Monday's quarterfinal, the win over Assumption for Minnesota Duluth.
And McIntosh is a physical player down low, so she's not afraid to go at Olson trying to fight for offensive rebounds. Olson has to be committed to boxing her out and making sure she's in position early, so McIntosh has to fight over her back.
So the first foul on Olson. First free throw for McIntosh. Take a look at Catawba out of Salisbury, North Carolina. Small school, notable alumni. How about Jim Tomsula, former 49ers coach? The South Atlantic Conference champions. Down the floor, Olson gets the layup to go. So that's the press and the downside of it. Olson all alone for a layup.
Oh, and that's how you break a press, trying to get the ball up the floor as quickly as possible. If you dribble, Catawba's going to come up, trap you, and get a steal.
Catawba wants that tempo to be fast. Minnesota Duluth played in a slow tempo game against Assumption in the quarterfinal. Assumption, by the way, the top defensive team in Division II. Wampler, pressure, clock down to three. Here's Thorne. Bats it off the backboard and gets fouled. Tatum Rhodes guilty of her first, team second.
The key to handling a press is try to get the ball up the floor as quickly as possible. The ball didn't even touch the ground. That is textbook press break from Minnesota Duluth. They need to continue trying to push the ball up as fast as possible.
A couple of substitutions already made on the side of Minnesota Duluth. As Taya Hakamaki comes in, the tough, hard-nosed guard off the bench. Here at Thorne, 72% from the line. Gets the roll. Minnesota Duluth. Of course, out of Duluth, Minnesota. Enrollment just under 10,000. They are a hockey powerhouse. You saw there in the notable alumni, Brett Hull, the Hall of Famer. Just a long legacy of great hockey players that played for Minnesota Duluth. Looking for their first ever women's basketball championship.
Hey, you gotta get up there with the hockey players, right? Come on now.
Gotta start somewhere in terms of matching. top reserves for the Bulldogs. Fires to the corner. A three by Granica way off. And here comes Catawba on the run. Downs lost it. Point guard Mason Thiessen. Thiessen at about 7.5 points per game. Lexi Cargi, the reserve big for Minnesota Duluth. Against McIntosh, turns and fades off front rim.
Really good defense by McIntosh, staying down and forcing Cargi out of the paint, but she was off balance on the attempt.
Catawba won the Southeast Regional. Greenville, South Carolina. In fact, of the four teams remaining, they're the only team that didn't host their regional. Thorne short on a three, and the rebound's back to them by Kaylee Nelson.
Well, the style that Catawba plays is really tough to go against because they speed you up, get you out of control, and want to keep you off balance.
Akamaki, blinding crossover, accelerates to the paint and gets fouled. So the quick guard, Taya Akamaki, will shoot two with a foul on Wampler.
Akamaki using that crossover, she got so low to the ground, it forced Wampler to come out of her stance, and as a result, she had the quickness advantage to get to the rim.
So Taya Akamaki, see that hometown, Cromwell, Minnesota. How about a population of 240?
What?
That's it, 240.
I bet she's the best baller in the city.
In fact, the high school is both the high school and elementary school, so just one school for Taya Akamaki.
I was waiting for you to say 240,000.
No, 240, that's the end of the sentence, put the period there. Janiyah Downs way off on a three, and Minnesota Duluth will get it.
The bench already getting in trouble for standing up. They're trying to have a good time over here.
Saw Terrence McCutcheon just then going to his bench a bit. Bringing in Maya DeBose for the first time, a sophomore from Minneapolis. High lob to the baseline. Deason gets rid of it. Oh, bumping down low around that free throw line area, and this is going to be a foul on Catawba.
In a national semifinal game, it's going to be a physical game because you got a lot to play for right now. Credit the way Catawba's trying to push Minnesota Duluth out of the paint and not let them have spots. They have to be careful with establishing their position and not fouling.
And Mary Stry is the one who fouled there. That is her first. This is that pressure defense. Doesn't matter if it's full court or half court. They'll try to trap.
And even if they don't get a turnover, they at least take time off the shot clock, so it forces the Bulldogs to speed up.
Gilbertson against Downs, clock down to five. Gilbertson wins the battle, flicking it home.
Gilbertson got underneath the arm just enough to have a clean look at the basket.
Minnesota Duluth within one. And great athleticism to tip the pass. Catawba continues with possession. Into the lane, a big bump. This drive can't finish. Opposite number 24, Olson with the rebound. Olson can shoot it. Rushes a three way off to the right. Images of the Pony Express National Museum, which is here in St. Joseph, Missouri. Spot of the Women's Basketball Division II semifinal. Catawba, Minnesota Duluth, early on. This ball will stay with Catawba, the team out of Salisbury, North Carolina. They have 12 to shoot.
Minnesota Duluth did a nice job early on preventing easy driving lanes. The help side defense has been there to kind of clog up the middle, so Catawba's not encouraged to get to the rim.
Lyric Thorne hasn't scored yet, still hasn't, as the layup rolls off the rim. Offensive rebound, step back, Ella Baker.
Second chance opportunities have been the bread and butter so far for Catawba. They are finishing every single play. Minnesota Duluth got knocked out.
And then Baker tips it away. The sophomore out of Pensacola, Florida, throws it up ahead. And there on the other end, Maya DeBose, a sophomore from Minneapolis.
The timing of the drop is impeccable, and you have somebody that can get right underneath the feet of the ball and steal it for two.
Rhodes can't deliver. This is the pace that Catawba wants. That press, running gun. DeBose pokes. Tries to scramble for it, does. Thorne is the team's leading scorer. Cross lane pass. Spry lays it in.
Thorne generating enough attention in the paint that led to an easy passing lane for the finish.
It's a 6-0 run, and that press continues to swarm. There's a reach and foul. Caught on Lauren Ford.
Catawba taking advantage of points off turnover. Minnesota Duluth's defense to shift. Leads to an open passing lane. Boom, buckets.
We saw Minnesota Duluth at practice yesterday working on the press break. You know you're going to get it when you're facing Catawba. There's a bump and a foul. Olson tried to go reverse. Sarah McIntosh, the opposite side center, picks up her first. That is the team's fourth.
Olson stays aggressive down low, constantly hunting for her shot. Even when it's not going in immediately, I like the level of physicality that she's willing to play with getting to the basket.
First connects. So you saw the Pony Express Museum a little bit earlier. Of course, you know, known as distance travel to deliver mail. Well, how about the road to St. Joe? The distance traveled for all the teams in the national quarterfinal to get here. Nobody extremely close.
No one close. I hope you downloaded some good Netflix shows to watch on the bus potentially. But ultimately, I think any of these teams would say they would travel any amount of distance it took if it meant they got to be in the national semifinals.
Put it on Mars. It doesn't matter. Gravity might be a little difficult.
Details.
A bump and a blocking foul on the drive. That's Lauren Ford in her second.
Gilbertson gets the defense up in the air, comes in, helps that defense look to be inside the restricted area.
So with 4-2 fouls, he heads to the bench. A couple of free throws for Ella Gilbertson. Had a big 12 points in the quarterfinal a couple of days ago in a 20-point win against Assumption. What a game that was for Coach Pearson and company. At 28 points off the bench. And that was huge because their player of the year, Brooke Olson, was in foul trouble. Was limited to just 17 minutes.
Especially as you get into late tournament time, it is so crucial to have balance and depth on the bench because situations like that occur. Teams get into foul trouble. You have to be able to find someone who has some juice on your bench.
Thorn. She just has such a live dribble. Every step could be the blow by. Baker with just 5. Acrobatic layup rolls off, but she is fouled. And she'll shoot 2. Tatum Rhodes, her second foul.
The Bulldogs have stayed committed to trying to guard inside of the 3-point line. Nice job by Catawba, still finding ways to get to the basket. Their guards are so quick and have the ability when using certain dribble fakes to get the defense up in the air, then boom, blow right past them.
It really is the opposite styles matchup. Talk about the quickness of Catawba. Minnesota Duluth has the best big in Division II in Brooke Olson. So it really is a styles contrast.
Minnesota Duluth likes to slow it down a little bit, get ball reversals. Catawba likes to speed you up. The question is, who's going to come out in the end? Is it going to be speed? Is it going to be style?
We will be playing in Dallas the 1st of April for the championship. There's Olson. Talk about that big. How about that drop step spin?
Love it. The step towards the middle gets the defense on her opposite side. Then boom, all she's got to do is that little drop step. Nice spin finish.
Rice Lake, Wisconsin.
Ooh.
And the opposite move. It's a good one. And it draws a second foul on Olson. And you can see the bench for Minnesota Duluth stunned. That is a huge moment. The second foul on the National Player of the Year.
And here's why she's the National Player of the Year. Crafty footwork in the paint. Fantastic ability to rework the defenses. Her movements are quick, they're deliberate, and they are to the rim. Then on the other end, Sarah McIntosh says, anything you can do, I can do better. Pulled off nearly the same exact move and was able to get Olson now into some foul trouble. Catawba has to take advantage of the Bulldogs having its best player on the bench.
So go to the bench as Gilbertson checks back in. McIntosh, her second. She was all-conference third team, the SAC. By the way, Catawba, the first team from the South Atlantic Conference to make the national semifinal. That's a foul about 80 feet away, which will have us walk the length of the floor as Catawba already over the limits. Maya DeBose is first.
Part of the style of play that Catawba has, they were more prone to fouling because they're so aggressive trying to come up and trap and get the passing lanes for steals. But at end of quarter situations, everyone needs to be aware of when the right time to take a gamble is because it could potentially end in a foul. You stop the shot clock and you give Minnesota Duluth an opportunity to put points on the board at the clock stop.
But how difficult is it to turn the switch on and off when it's your style of play?
It's much easier said than done when I can sit here and say, when it's your style of play, you keep that foot on the gas pedal. But it's important just to have the awareness.
Lexi Cargi gets the second chance bucket, and that's big. She's in replacement of Olson, who's on the bench with fouls. She'll likely play a big role, and there's an offensive foul. It's called on Catawba. Second on Sarah McIntyre. So both starting centers already with foul trouble.
It's a physical matchup down low, and you have to also be aware of how the officials are calling it. If you can't have a ton of contact generated, you got to be really careful and aware. It's going to adjust the style which you can play.
You see what she do? Terrence McCutcheon wondering, Monty, the explanation.
Hey, you know what? It's a good question to ask. And for some coaches, a lot of them are asking that to the officials at many different times.
In the point guard leaves for the big, and Cargi the air ball, and it's out of bounds. Catawba possession.
Pretty good job by Catawba guarding that ball screen. Saw Cargi go to the short corner, but didn't have a great angle at the basket, results in an air ball.
Coach McCutcheon for Catawba said, we want to speed the game up. Already a lot of possessions early in this one. Spry uses the ball fake. Thorne, player of the year in her conference, bumps, regathers into the lane, and another foul drawn. And Spry will head to the free throw line this time.
Catawba has been killing Minnesota Duluth down low, generating second chance opportunities. The lack of box outs killed the Bulldogs.
How difficult for a player is it to adjust when it is a tight whistle in such an important game? You want to make those big plays, but also the whistle might prevent you from taking those risks.
You have to be really careful, but boxing out is key, just trying to get to the position early on, because if you can establish the position first, then the officials are going to have to look for the over-the-back call.
Spry, good at the line. She's the team's best free throw shooter at 84%. Press broken with the pass to Nelson. Akamaki gets rid of it to the corner, and there's the three. Madeline Granica, a senior at Emory, Wisconsin.
Paint touches lead to open threes. As soon as you get a paint touch, the defense collapses. Boom, open three-point line.
And the first lead of the game for Minnesota Duluth. A lot of bumping down low. That time not a foul. Good defense by Cargi. Bulldogs hold for one. Beeson off the screen, tosses back. Cargi bullies and travels. It was the travel before the horn. It's for the expiration of the first quarter.
Hacking on the pressure. As good as the pressure has been, it has to be a pressure that's under control. Trying to get into passing lanes, but watching the contact.
Janiyah Downs at the line. She really struggled in the win that Catawba had on Monday against the 3C Cal State Dominguez Hills. Just 2 points, was just 1-for-7 shooting, and at times pretty emotionally upset, visibly upset, you could see it. 1 point Lyric Thorne, her fellow senior, had to calm her down, but the team got the win in there in the semis.
Nothing gives you more confidence, by the way, than when your teammates have your back and have the ability to say, hey, it's going to be okay. Ride with us here. And that's what teams that are at the stage have, really good chemistry. And you need to have great chemistry in order to be a championship team.
Akamaki, wide pass to the corner. Cargi, the backup big, with five to shoot, working against Spry. Spry wins the battle that time.
Spry staying up and down, using her feet to move and not letting Cargi have any easy look at the basket.
Tip pass into the lane. There's Cargi. I'll make that Spry. Mary Spry, the freshman, lays it in.
Beautiful, beautiful cut by Spry nonetheless.
Corner three, that one goes. Another long ball. Taya Hakamaki. Team's best three-point shooter. She's at 39%. Tied at 22 was Catawba getting off to the roaring start. Minnesota Duluth finished that first quarter on a 12-4 run. Standing tall defensively, Lexi Cargi. Free throw line, Jay is perfect. Mason Beeson.
Nice Nice shot by Thiessen reading the defense. Defense got hit on the screen. She had just enough time to get the shot off under rhythm.
Downs responds and one. Spinning like a top. Falls to the ground and has a chance at a three-point play.
I like that, spinning like a top. That's exactly what just happened, Chris Lewis. The spin coming from Downs, and she just gets low, takes, splits traffic, and you saw the help side defense come over and use the body. Really nice job by Downs, absorbing the contact, still finishing towards the rim to get the bucket to go.
We're drawing the foul on Carvey. Three-point play for Janiyah Downs. And Minnesota Duluth. Brooke Olson with those two fouls. Tatum Rhodes also two fouls. The two key players, starters, all conference caliber players, having to take a seat. Gilbertson, step through, an extra step. That's a travel.
When Catawba can hold its ground down low, good things happen, especially when you get to the position first. Establish where you are. Minnesota Duluth has been off balance when they catch the ball inside because Catawba is getting to the spot first.
And what a year it's been for Catawba. They've never been past the second round of the NCAA tournament. This is their third straight. And an extra step this time on the Indians, Janiyah Downs.
Now we're just trading turnovers at this point.
That's the fourth on Catawba, the ninth combined between these teams. Gilbertson lobs on the receiving end. The layup does drop. Brooke Olson, who is back in with those two fouls. So key minutes here in the second quarter, hoping she doesn't pick up another. Thorne lays it up and in. So that's perhaps recognizing the opposite side big is two fouls. So how about you attack the rim?
Exactly what the doctor ordered. And Thorne's so quick to get into the basket. She can beat anybody off the dribble.
Nelson pass fake to use for the dribble, speeding to the rim and drawing the contact. She'll head to the free throw line for a pair.
Brooke Olson is excellent at establishing position, but even a better pass from Gilbertson to where only Olson could catch it on the lob on the outside hand. And then on the other way, I mean, my goodness, Thorne getting to the basket. It takes her like two steps from the top of the three-point line to get all the way to the rim. She has such a quick trigger when it comes to those feet and finishing.
27 points in this building on Monday, highlighted by that dribble drive. Haley Nelson, that defensive specialist. She says she loves defense, guards the opposite team's best players. She hits a couple of free throws.
You don't meet very many players that say they love defense. Most players love scoring, so you gotta cherish the ones that really are committed to the defensive end.
Averaging less than three per game as a starter. Wampler takes the contested three off to the left. Thiessen jogs, maneuvers, double high screen, and a bump. Thorne looks in disbelief.
Thiessen just weaving her way through, using the screen well. Thorne just trying to get through. And the shoulder lowers from Thorne is just where she's going to get cowed for the foul.
Olson catch and shoot from a center. Off a pin down.
She is automatic. Comes down off the pin down. And she's able to get her feet and shoulder set quickly. All she's got to worry about is that release.
I mean, that ability at that size is rarely seen. Knocked away by Granica, stays here.
And it's what Coach McCutcheon for Catawba told us he was most concerned about, how confident Olson is shooting the three. She comes off shoulder squared. She has a shooter's mentality to where her shoulders are always facing the basket and her feet are always set the moment she comes off a screen.
Four-time All-American and the D2 Player of the Year. Thorne off the rim and there's Olson for the board. She makes such a difference. She's back in, and Minnesota Duluth up a couple of possessions with the ball, and that's a carry. Yeah, that was an easy one to spot from Thiessen.
keep that hand on top of the ball.
Coach Mandy Pearson says she did. It was just a high dribble. Officials say that hand got underneath.
You called that pretty quickly, Chris.
Last thing I want to do is get those stripes.
It's the hardest job. Hardest job in America.
About it. Baker surrounded. Wampler's the outlet. Thorne wants three. Get her three.
Nice job by Catawba, moving the ball with some pace. They went inside, forced the defense to shift, and led to an open look.
Thorne has seven. One behind Spry for the team lead. Olson just showed off the three-point touch. How about the block touch?
Oh, come on. That's just unfair. Olson's ability to get shots when she's not in the correct position necessarily. Everybody in a gold jersey, but I like the double screens. It's hard to guard because the defense has to constantly be paying attention where the screen is coming from.
And how does having a versatile center like Brooke Olson open up an offense?
Oh, it's huge because a player like Brooke Olson is going to garner the attention of the post player on Catawba, who probably doesn't want to defend out the three-point line anyway, so he just spreads the offense and allows for more driving lanes for the Bulldogs.
Minnesota Duluth, the ball up three. Their 15th NCAA tournament all time, fifth in a row. They've never gotten this deep to the national semifinal. Olson surrounded. Akabaki. Fires. Locked down to just three. There's the pivot from Granica. Reverse pivot. Scoop off the backboard. Doesn't hit rim. Shot clock violation.
Nice job by Catawba forcing Granica out of good position. So she was a little further away for that type of move to be effective using contact going to the basket.
What do you think of the pace right now in this second quarter?
Well, the pace favors Minnesota Duluth, who like to run things a little slower, get through possessions on offense. If Catawba can speed up the pace, Minnesota Duluth will turn the ball over.
Downs against that reach by Hakamaki. Thorne slices.
Ooh.
No look pass on the baseline, but DeBose can't pay it off.
I like the no look, though. Credit to that.
Oof. My eyes even went to the wing.
I know, man.
Akamaki against Thorne is a fun head-to-head. Akamaki takes the matchup to go to the rim, drawing the foul on Thorne. Second foul on Lyric Thorne, the senior out of High Point, North Carolina, who leads the team with over 19 per game. So Thorne remaining in at this point with her second foul. We'll see how long Coach McCutcheon will keep her in. Coming up on AT&T at the half, we'll have a conversation with Ashland head coach Kerry Pickens as we'll preview our second semifinal. A look back on Glenville State. They're participating in that game. Their run last year to the championship. We'll have also highlights and stats coming up on AT&T at the half.
How lucky are we? We get a close game here. It's going to be a fantastic matchup next game as well. The Division II women's basketball represented well by these teams.
Ashland that's undefeated and Glenville State the defending champs. What a matchup that is. A reach from Thiessen to knock it out of bounds. It remains with Catawba. See that Minnesota Duluth bench and behind their fan section. They are loud. They are proud. Made the difference in the win against Assumption. Thorne step back, no. Tussle for the board, and Mason Thiessen, fifth-year senior, takes possession.
Really impressive the way the Bulldogs have been able to control pace in the second quarter. They're not getting too rushed, taking their time. Just that extra second has made all the difference.
Akamaki, your two long steps and muscles the ball off the rim. Coach Mandy Pearson says she's tough and hard-nosed coming off the bench. Evidence there on that drive. Travel on Sarah McIntosh gives it back to Minnesota Duluth. They have their largest lead at six.
Minnesota Duluth has been able to establish great balance inside and outside. They've already knocked down three threes in this game. So now Catawba is forced to come out to the three-point line of multiple players, and it opens up driving lanes.
And there is that steal Catawba lives for. That trapping in transition, and Nala Baker gets the hoop in the arm. And she'll have a chance to complete a three-point play.
Baker reads the passing lane so well, comes over like a D-back in coverage, gets the tip, pick six on the other end, and with a little contact, putting a little something extra on it.
All she was missing was a touchdown dance.
I mean, that was it. It probably would have been the gritty. I feel like that's the most popular touchdown dance nowadays.
Funny, even Justin Jefferson did it that one game and faked the hamstring injury. I got nervous for my fantasy team.
Can't be doing that now.
That is a big moment. A foul on Lyric Thorne about 70 feet away. Her third foul.
It's difficult to stay disciplined with the style of play Catawba has because they want to try to run and jump and try to trap as much as possible for 94 feet. But you have to be aware of your foul count as a player and when you can take a gamble and when you have to be more conservative.
So that is huge for Catawba. All region first team, conference player of the year. Three fouls during the first half. Akamaki, she's had her head down, driving to the rim all quarter. That time stumbles out of bounds, loses the ball. It belongs to Catawba.
That was nice one-on-one defense from Catawba because they forced Akamaki to throw up a wild shot at the end. She thought she had the quickness advantage, but the help of the defense was right there.
So how important is this last 1:45 really for Catawba with their top player on the bench?
Yeah, the Lady Indians have to make sure they're getting the ball inside, trying to get fouled as well to get to the free throw line and see the ball go in the basket that way.
It's called a kick ball. So no foul there. Kick ball. Reset the shot clock to 20. Coach McCutcheon with Thorne on the bench. Terrence McCutcheon is a player back at the College of Southern Idaho and Nicholls State. I mean, that's the opposite corners of the country.
No kidding.
Top of the circle, Jade. No for Gilbertson. The Bows tried to go behind the back. Duluth said no. Akamaki has made herself a factor here in this second quarter. Screen from Cargi. Three launched off a bit. Shorts. Catawba can tie it with a triple. Not a great three-point shooting team, below 30% on the year. Blinding spin, but no roll from Downs.
And Downs just had to flip that shoulder a little over more to be more square to the basket and finish.
Downs late getting back. And that close out a bit late as well, but Thiessen resets. Thiessen weaves. Up to the block. Cargi carves, off glass and in.
Good angle off the glass as well for Cargi to where the Catawba could not block it.
Semifinal number one. Minnesota Duluth, the two seed. 5-point lead, last possession of the second quarter. Downs, bobbles, accelerates, fades, air ball. That'll do it for the first half. After falling behind early, Minnesota Duluth controlled the second frame, led by as many as six, and take the 5-point lead in the half.
Credit how the Bulldogs were able to control pace of play. Catawba, though, has a very good chance of coming out here and speeding things up in the second half. That is a wild game we are in for the second half here as Minnesota Duluth leads by five.
So Minnesota Duluth, and this is the deepest run that they've ever had in the NCAA tournament, facing a team with the same resume and a double dribble on Kaylee Nelson to start the second half.
That's the pace that Catawba wants to come out with, get a turnover, try to generate a little bit of momentum, but also trying to establish more of an inside-out game. I'd like to see Thorne get to the basket on this possession.
So Thorne in with those three fouls to start half number two, misses the runner.
She got a good look, though. Just has to turn that shoulder towards the basket. She's anticipating contact right now.
Olson. All the pivots. Can't get the angle, but gets hits the O-board. Second chance is perfect. 17 for Olson.
Olson is so patient in the post. She just waits to see what the defense is going to do. Then she attacks.
Seven-point lead is the largest of the game for the Bulldogs. Thorne denied. Clock at five. Has to be a rush three from Downs. McIntosh boxes out a little too aggressively and is called for the foul. Her third.
McIntosh is able to clean it up in the first half. She's got to be careful, but Olson is just so smart the way she moves, efficient, faces up, gets the defense on her back, then makes her move accordingly. Even though she misses, stays with the play. It's really impressive how patient she stays.
Rhodes lobs, that's intercepted. McIntosh steps in front. Downs delivers, back door, Wampler swatted, or at least altered by Minnesota Duluth. Olson. See Granica turning down a three. She's just a 22% three-point shooter. Much more comfortable there, down low, misses there and gets fouled. Should say commits the foul. Madeline Granica second.
Control. He's trying to go up and follow the miss.
Now both of these teams with big comebacks in their regional final. For Minnesota Duluth, they were down by 20 in their comeback win against Missouri Southern. Catawba, they were down 10 against Georgia Southwestern. Both of these teams have experience being down in the second half. Thorne navigates, but can't lay it in.
Thorne's getting to the basket. She just hasn't been able to finish. Part of the way Minnesota Duluth has been disruptive on the drive.
Olson overheads. Gilbertson tries a teardrop. Front iron. Rebound gobbled up by Mercedes Wampler. Catawba still looking for their first field goal this half. Thorne, long strides. And that's a tie-up. So not a foul. They call that a tie-up, and the arrow keeps it on this side. Saturday night, 6 Eastern, CBS Sports Network brings you Athletes Unlimited Basketball with the world's best pro women's ballers. So they go head-to-head one final time this season for a chance to be crowned a 2023 champ here on the 24-hour home of CBS Sports.
It's a great league, by the way. A lot of WNBA players going to Athletes Unlimited. And it's nice options. They don't have to go overseas now. They can stay in the States.
High-level basketball. Just like this, high level for a spot in a championship game. Step back, Thorne triggers a three off to the left. Rhodes, the do-it-all forward. Outlets, Hakamaki, no. Thorne continues to turn on the Jets. Maybe a little too much there.
Thorne's getting frustrated because she hasn't been able to score at the rim, but she has to be careful as she becomes more of a playmaker, has to get her teammates involved, because right now Minnesota Duluth is focusing all of its attention on her.
Cargi and McIntosh locking horns. Cargi, two-handed shot, nearly fell. Ties on this end on offense. Corner keeps it, loses it, but stays. That's Catawba.
Catawba's getting to the basket. They simply just can't finish right now.
Is that the length of Minnesota Duluth?
It's disruption, but also just a lack of focus and thinking that the contact is coming when it's not. And so you anticipate the contact, so you might overshoot it because you think you're getting hit.
Olson's back to the basket. Flat down to just five. Spry barrels. And a blocking foul.
Nice job by Catawba getting to the line. When the ball's not going in during your possession, just try to get fouled, get to the line. Watch the ball go in to get a little bit of confidence as a team from the straight.
See Cargi heading to the bench as the first free throw up and through. Mary Spry, strong first half with 6 points. She's over her season average, now up to eight. Catawba still without a field goal in the third quarter. But their defense has turned it up. You can see the drop there. That's still on for Minnesota Duluth with the interior miss from Olson. It's a foul in the paint. Early seal for Spry, and the foul goes against the Bulldogs.
Nice job by Spry. Generate a little bit of contact. I like the battle in the paint because it's going to be important to establish a paint presence for Catawba. They just have to make sure that they're finishing plays now and they get those high percentage opportunities.
Gilbertson with the active hands. I have a feeling as this third quarter turns into a fourth, every single pass, every single dribble will be even more contested. Thorne one-on-one against Rhodes, takes it to the rim. There's the foul. So he said anticipating the contact, maybe overdoing it a bit. That time looked like Thorne went straight through.
And Thorne's trying really hard to get fouled right now with her intent driving to the basket. But I would just like to see her focus on the finish versus focusing on when the contact's gonna come.
Third foul on Rhodes. She had two early fouls in the first quarter. Thorne got to the line 12 times against Cal State Dominguez Hills. Made 10 of the free throws in the quarterfinal.
Her bread and butter when she can get to the line by driving. But what's nice about shooting free throws is not the top, it's set up in their press.
Got them both. And here is that press. Toss across half court, beats it for Minnesota Duluth. Olson double team, goes with the baseline hook.
Good job by Spry keeping Olson in one and none because she has the ability to high rate to get that board and finish the play.
Downs. Great job reaching from behind after she was beat by Taya Hakamaki as Lyric Thompson continues to put the ball on the floor, try to get to the rim. Lyric Thorne, Catawba down three.
In the workload, that is just extremely impressive.
Catawba. Possession out of the timeout, down as many as seven, back within three. Thorne fires to the corner, three off the back of the rim from Baker. Oh, for their last six are the Bulldogs. Hakamaki across the lane for Olson.
Unselfish play. Right, how Hakamaki was able to draw multiple players towards her, left an open passing lane to for the finish.
A 5-point lead for Minnesota Duluth. Down strips and a foul. It's on Minnesota Duluth. Taya Hakamaki second.
And fantastic job getting a paint touch from a drive. Olson gets to the eye-line side of her teammate, keeps the ball up high. Easy buckets.
Catawba in the bonus. And perfect from Downs. All South Atlantic Conference second team, the senior. And at China Grove, North Carolina. First player for the Indians in double figures.
Catawba's gotten back into this game because they've been able to get to the foul line. a huge key to success. When you cannot score in the half court, try to get to the rim, get fouled, watch the ball go in from the stripe and get confidence that way, and it allows Catawba to then to set up in its press.
Just like the wheel keeps on spinning. You score, you get the free throw, then you can set up the press. Makes it more likely you'll score, and that's a double dribble in the backcourt. Mason Thiessen put that second hand on it. Turnover.
The ball comes over off the, she caught the ball. It's a double dribble. That's the right call.
Turnover starting to tally, the 11th for Minnesota Duluth. Thorne off the back of the defender, Gilbertson. Wrestling match for the ball. Tie up in the arrow this time gives it to Minnesota Duluth.
Bulldogs have to find a way to break this press quickly by passing it up either the side or in the middle.
Instead, it's just individual effort by Gilbertson to break it going down that side.
But it takes 10 seconds off the shot clock, so the Catawba press very effective on that possession, even though it's not a turnover.
Right, they haven't even gotten it inside the three-point line, just them with 10 to shoot. But Olsen's a good player to have the ball off the side of the backboard. Baker zooms, examines. Gilbertson got a piece for Minnesota Duluth to get the steal. Trying for the save, and Thiessen bobbling it. It was not the way. Minnesota Duluth keeps it, but every pass, every touch, much more difficult here in the third quarter.
Impressive how Catawba's really dialed in, especially when the ball goes inside, trying to make things difficult for Olson. But she makes things easy for herself, because if she gets deep positioning, it is game over. She can put the defender on her back and spin into space.
The second all-time leading scorer at Minnesota Duluth. She has all 6 points for the Bulldogs in the half. Turnaround, altered. Doesn't go for forward. From the ball. This might be Ford. Indeed it is. Ford's third.
Olson fights her way to get deep positioning. She was a little out of the space to begin with, but just off the catch, backing down her defender. Her strength and ability to use her body, sealing with her hips, makes her so difficult to defend.
You said it at halftime. It seemed like a quiet 15. She can rack up points fast. This time, hook shot almost went with the hook.
I was going to say, if you call her a microwave score, she heats up in a hurry.
You see right there, they haven't made a field goal yet in the third quarter. It's Catawba. Got it off in the line. How about this for a field goal? No, that's off to the right.
Catawba has not taken great shots within possession. They've been contested. They've been rushed. I'd like to see some ball reversals to get in-rhythm shots by forcing Minnesota Duluth to shift defensively.
Haven't made a field goal all third quarter, Catawba, but yet they are even with Minnesota Duluth. 6 points apiece in the frame. Defense has upped it another level. Clock down to just two. Gilbertson, too strong. Down low, McIntyre's that lid still on the basket from the field here in the third. Minnesota Duluth just 3 for 13 in the quarter. Catawba still hasn't made a field goal in the frame. Olson across the lane pass and draws a foul, does Gilbertson. It's the fourth on Ford. And more free throws for the Bulldogs.
And the Bulldogs have controlled pace of play on the offensive end by taking their time, getting reversals, allowing everybody to touch the ball. It's forced Catawba to have to defend late into his shot clock. And then at the end, they're making clouded decisions because they've been on defense for so long.
Gilbertson in and out. I mean, spending a lot of the game on one end of the floor, especially that defensive side. You said it earlier. Not many people love defense.
I know. I don't love defense. So I can tell you that, Chris, from experience. Yeah.
More you spend on that end, taking away from the offense. Gilbertson hits the second. This could be the last possession of the third quarter for the Indians to finally make a field goal. Thorne, step through, halfway down, pops out. And with the shot clock turned off, that might be the last chance that the Indians have for a field goal in the third. Right across before that 10 counts. Eason. Olson wants her to come to it. That great screen forces a rotation. Gilbertson, bullseye to end the third quarter. Largest lead for Minnesota Duluth. On their own, but they've built their lead up to the largest it's been all game.
Credit the way Minnesota Duluth defended, forced Catawba to take contested shots. But the way the Indians have to find a way to get to the basket and find some balance with establishing an inside-outside game.
Chris Lewis, Megan McEwen, here in St. Joe, Missouri. 10 more minutes for one of these teams who had the Dallas on April 1st for the D2 championship. Gilbertson, nobody there to pick her up and lays it in. Ella Gilbertson, and for the first time all game, a team has a double-digit lead.
Olson made that happen because the defense was so drawn to what she was going to do. Gilbertson was able to keep it for herself.
Balance pump fakes. McIntosh nearly picked. And defense continues to rotate. There's a field goal finally in the second half. Janiyah Downs. Just the third three in a game for the Indians.
Exactly.
Todd has no problem getting to the basket. So it's a matter of forcing those rotations and getting those open looks from the perimeter,
and
too.
And even when the defense shifts, you can lead to open driving lanes on the opposite side because you move the ball with pace.
Out of the stoppage, Ella Gilbertson, her second field goal of the fourth quarter. Minnesota Duluth back up double digits. Winner of this faces the winner of Ashland and Glenville State to follow. Downs another three, can't make it two straights. Offensive rebound underneath, the Bows won't go. Minutes and change. Minnesota Duluth has never been in a national championship game. In fact, this is their first time playing in the semis. And Rhodes had her shoe on the baseline, that St. Joseph baseline here in Missouri. Terrence McCutcheon calling out instructions, his team down 10. McIntosh bumps, and it goes. Boy, do the Indians need that one from Sarah McIntosh.
Pick, roll, create space, and boom. Olson out of position defensively, help side there is late. Fantastic finish by McIntosh. Absorbing the contact, but throwing it off the backboard just high enough to have the proper angle.
And the fourth foul on Rhodes. McIntosh caps it off, the three-point play. Just a seven-point game. A bump and a foul. The press, once again, a little too aggressive. Maya DeBose, her second. Once again, Gilbertson turns the corner and gets fouled this time. Well, they say the foul on the floor, so the foul after the shot got flicked up on the rim will stay with Minnesota Duluth.
Gilbertson comes over, and that's the right call because you see the contact come on the box out over, and the shoulder is lowered.
Olson off the end now. That's a well-designed play by Mandy Pearson.
A well-designed play because Olson is so quick and deliberate the moment she gets the ball. Her decision-making, boom, gets to the basket.
McIntosh double-teamed, up with it anyway. Takes a couple of bounces. Pinballs off, gets it back, and shows off the muscles. Gets fouled and will strut to the stripe.
How about this inbounds play? We saw moments ago from Minnesota Duluth. The fake screen. Olson comes up like she's got a pick. Then she gets the screen. Poof. Some fancy misdirection by the Bulldogs.
The player of the year in Division II on the receiving end of that look. She's been locking up with Sarah McIntosh throughout the night. McIntosh catches the first free throw. A 76% shooter. Gets both. Granica re-enters for Minnesota Duluth. Take a look at the foul trouble on both sides. Lauren Ford has four for Catawba. It's Tatum Rhodes with four personals for Minnesota Duluth. Remember, Brooke Olson had two fouls early in the first quarter. She still has two in this game.
You have to be careful when you know your foul count, making sure you're finding ways to stay aggressive but under control.
Beeson, the point guard, pounding DeBose off the screen. Cargi rolls, and a foul called on DeBose for Catawba. Third team foul already.
Well, DeBose is trying to go over the screen. And to me, I don't see why that's a foul. She's just trying to get through the screen, runs into it. But to me, that's not a foul on DeBose.
Third team foul, so just one more to give. Olson reinserted and gets it off glass. 25 for Olson. Thorne slices, hooks, back iron and off. Hakamaki with the board for the Bulldogs and gets hammered to the ground. It's been a difficult night for Thorne.
Minnesota Duluth has made things very difficult for Catawba on the offensive end because they're clogging up the paint. There's just not a ton of room to move inside the three-point line.
So how do you create more space?
Well, you got to get ball reversals. You got to try to get paint touches and play inside, outside. If you could knock down a couple threes, that would also help. But also, Catawba's gotten to the rim. They just can't finish at times.
To press once again, and Minnesota Duluth with the lead. They have no problem slowing it up. Beeson sees the crease, the lane open, a big crease, but misses the layup. Wampler. Her downs. Skips into the paint, flips it up, and gets fouled. She flexes her elbow. There is finally another foul on Olson, her third in the act.
Catawba needs to continue trying to get to the rim, get fouled. But ultimately, they got to find some offense when they generate some inside-outside. By getting to the rim, now Minnesota Duluth has to collapse a little more, be patient on the drive. But Catawba needs shooters to try to get into corners so they at least have some other threats from the outside.
The Catawba offense is grinding into a halt in the second half. Where they are just 2-for-18 shooting since halftime. They are getting to the line, which is helping. Now 11-for-11 from the stripe since halftime.
They can get there. They're converting. Just have to continue finding ways to get there. Even trying to get some and one so they can cut this lead a little faster.
Baker checks in. As Downs heads out for the Indians. Minnesota Duluth has had the arms distance lead ever since early in the third. Clock at just 7. Beeson has to play make. Olson from the point. Whistle and a travel.
Really good defense by Catawba because the help came over, stayed down. Boom, there's the first blow by. The help comes over. Multiple help comes over. And Olson, too, was expecting a little contact on that, but instead, jumping straight up and down. Catawba making a little bit of a pushback.
National TV, then. These
that's
players are used
that's
to.
Yeah, fault,
it's
way.
It's
yeah.
us. Yeah, yeah.
We're the problem.
Gotta,
it's us.
Gotta happen somehow. So you get longer breaks. How does that affect teams, especially late in the game? Is that bank goes through Tana Border? What a three for Catawba.
Well, maybe it rests up some legs so Catawba can start hitting threes. But from the standpoint of momentum, it can disrupt flow if you're not used to having longer breaks. But part of the way both Catawba and Minnesota Duluth have handled the longer breaks is just going to come down to Catawba getting stops and capitalizing with points off turnovers.
Second three of the half. Air ball from Gilbertson. Catawba. This half, 3 for 19 shooting. They are somehow down only 4. Never say die attitude. Elbow J, downs won't go down.
That was a good shot, just the shot didn't fall.
There's Akimaki, wiggles, bounces to nowhere. DeBose vacuums it up, zips to the paint, misses the layup in transition. On the run, the Bulldogs. Brooke Olson drops steps, then it goes off glass.
Great job of using the offhand as well to generate the space that the block could not come. Excellent awareness.
Her parents, Forrest and Darla, both college basketball players. And Brooke Olson on the big stage, the national semis, gets the bucket. Minnesota Duluth with a steal. Thiessen gets fouled. And she will walk to the free throw line. Fourth foul on DeBose, who missed on this end.
Well, the turnover came, but DeBose just cannot convert. Catawba has not been able to convert on points over turnovers at a high rate. And then just a nice job by Olson on the other end, getting deep position, dealing with the defenses, and then using her offhand to block the hand of the defender so she has a clean look at the rim.
That was a great shot we just saw. Director Ryan Cause right there with Coach Terrence McCutcheon giving a word to his young guard, his sophomore out of Minneapolis, Maya DeBose. Make the mistake, missing the layup, commit the foul, but hey, there's still time left, 3:40. Still time to make up for it, just a two-possession game. Downs. That won't go either. A couple of good looks for Janiyah Downs. Minnesota Duluth trying to put on the finishing touches. The NSIC champs. Olson, a healthy three. Wide right. What a board by Rhodes. Just a winning player for the Bulldogs.
That can't happen for the Indians. They have to box out every single possession. They cannot allow Minnesota Duluth to just run time off the block with this lead.
Gilbertson, teardrop. Back iron. There's Olson. Brooke Olson, the takeover in Missouri. T9 points for the Division II Player of the Year. Downs chisels and finally gets it off glass.
Get to the basket and focus on the finish. Catawba's just been throwing it up when they get down to a high percentage area. Focus on finishing and don't expect the contact to be there.
Olson gets it on the outlet and draws the foul on McIntosh. Olson's an 85% free throw shooter, and she'll get a pair.
Olson is constantly putting herself in a position to be successful. Coming in, no one boxes her out, no one in sight. She sneaks down there. She's 6'2". It can't be that sneaky. But on the other side, Downs really finding a gap, getting towards the basket. When she finished at the rim that time, her shoulders were squared and she was finishing towards the rim.
Saying the 6'2 player has heavy steps.
I mean, like, hey, you gotta find her. She's the tallest player on the floor.
McIntosh has her fourth foul. It's a 30 piece for Brooke Olson in the semis. 31.
Instead, it felt like a quiet 15 in the first half. This felt like a loud 15 in the second.
Prior to foul trouble in the quarterfinals, she was averaging 32 in the tournament. That was a much-needed three by Downs.
Downs has entered the chat in the best way possible for Catawba.
20 points in the chat. Backdoor Gilbertson goes reverse. Now the offense is picking up with 95 seconds left. Downs continues the heater. No. I don't think she was kicked out of the chat for one miss.
No, they'll still keep running, okay. But maybe better, more open look next time.
A minute 15 to go. Minnesota Duluth has been the front runners the entire second half. Beeson bounces, and that ball's kicked, which resets the shot clock to 20, which is big with just a minute three left.
I mean, Catawba's going to have to make a decision now, and with this little time left, I think they need to start fouling just to try to get an extra possession.
See what Coach McCutcheon decides to do here with the Bulldogs throwing it in. No foul yet. Pressure, though.
There's pressure, but they're not going to have enough possessions. They don't get a stop here.
Olson navigates corner. Skip feed. Beeson. Front iron. Pinball rebound. It is scooped up. Catawba possession.
They got to score quick. They don't have enough time.
Thorne has been quiet. Takes the three. No. Offensive board. That stiff back won't fall from Baker. Still contested. Gilbertson wins the battle. Shot clock turned off. Minnesota Duluth with a lead. They give it away. Thorne accelerates and lays it in. That is her first field goal of the second half. Boy, what a wild sequence. With a spot in the title at stake, we'll be back in 30 from Missouri.
Yes, correct. Or get a steal. They're going to play it.
Wow. Olson finally, although McIntosh probably didn't want to commit the foul herself, she had four, and she was the closest there. So instead, Downs has to come over from the opposite side to commit the foul, but valuable time goes off the clock.
And you have to be aware as a team what the foul count is, and that's usually talked about in the timeout. Hey, so-and-so has four fouls, three fouls. That communication awareness has to be there in end-of-game situations.
The door left ajar with that miss. Olson's first miss at the line. All-important second. It's a three-possession game. A younger sister watching as a freshman on the team. Thorne, air ball. And with 12.4 left, down three possessions. Minnesota Duluth, Coach Mandy Pearson signaled for a timeout. And I just want to make sure they get it in here. Take no chances against this press.
Yeah, smart decision to advance the ball so the press can't get set up from a 94-feet perspective. Look, Catawba's got to get a steal real quick, or they've got a foul just to generate a possession. But be aware of who has four fouls on the floor. McIntosh has four fouls. You can't let her be the one that's in the situation to foul.
Two great coaches in the semifinals to face the winner of Ashland and Glenville State to follow this one here on CBS Sports Network. That's a great one, by the way. You want to make sure you're locked and ready for it. Ashland unbeaten. Still hasn't suffered a loss all year. Glenville State, defending champions, play with a unique style. You won't want to miss it next on CBS Sports Network.
I don't want to miss it, that's for sure.
Olson is fouled. That's McIntosh, and that is her fifth. So she is fouled out. The senior center, all South Athletic Conference, third team. 9 points, 8 rebounds for the standout. So more free throws for Olson, continuing to add to the point tally. She has been the most dominant player so far in the NCAA tournament. Meanwhile, what a year it's been for Catawba. First ever trip to the national semifinal. First team from their conference to ever make it this far. Going to be just short from a trip to the championship. Thorne with an air ball. Minnesota Duluth possession with 6 seconds. And Thorne commits the foul.
I'm really impressed with how Minnesota Duluth handled this pressure down the stretch. It wasn't pretty at times, still 15 turnovers by the Bulldogs, but they were still able to control pace of play, work the ball, get multiple players involved. Overall, just a really solid floor game for everybody in a gold jersey.
That's a tough ending for the player in the red jersey, Lyric Thorne, as she is fouled out. The South Athletic Conference Player of the Year. Had a great NCAA tournament as well. Tough one. She was the attention from that Minnesota Duluth team. Beeson. Catch. March Sadness.
Part of the season Catawba has been able to put together to get to a national semifinal for the first time ever is absolutely remarkable, and they have a lot to be proud of.
3 seconds, last look, and Duluth keeps on dancing to Dallas. They'll play for a championship for the first time in school history as Minnesota Duluth wins 70-59.